All right. Next up is again a very interesting topic. Build a robust model to leapfrog your business. And this is going to be presented by Mr. Ashish. Ashish Somaya, MD and CEO, Motilal Oswal Mutual Fund. A big round of applause to him, please. And may I request Mohsin Bejapuri to kindly escort Ashish onto the stage. And may I request Mr. Mohsin Bejapuri to kindly felicitate Mr. Ashish with a shawl.
I don't know who was escorting whom.
Can we all give a big round of applause, please? A small brief about Mr. Ashish P. Somaya, Managing Director and CEO, Motilal Oswal Asset Management Company Limited. Mr. Ashish brings with him rich and varied experience with more than 13 years in sales and distribution, channel management, product development and institutional sales from ICICI Prudential AMC, and brief stint at project management with Bharti AXA Investment Manager. His last assignment was with ICICI Prudential as Senior VP and Head. Mr. Ashish holds a Bachelor of Engineering in Polymer Science and a Master's in Management Studies in Finance from Mumbai. A big round of applause to him as I hand over the stage to you. Thank you so much.
Good evening. So warm welcome to all of you. And thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to come here and speak to all of you. I think I should congratulate the entire team at IFA Galaxy for organizing it in such a wonderful manner. Because if we were standing outside the room, I couldn't have told you warm welcome. It's very warm outside. You have the luxury of saying warm welcome only inside this hall. So it's my pleasure to be here, and thank you once again. So the topic given to me was actually very, very difficult. And I will protest about that later. But the topic was very difficult, and whenever I find the topic very difficult, what I do is that I split it into different words, because if you see, it says building a robust model to leapfrog your business. Out of five, there are two or three words whose meaning I did not understand. So the first thing I did was to go to this site called dictionary.com. And I suggest all of you should do that once in a while and look very closely what the meaning of each of these words is. So if you see the word leapfrogging, on the left-hand side, you actually see a normal frog. And on the right-hand side, you can see a frog which is actually leapfrogging. And for a moment, just see the note I have made downstairs. What does it actually say? Do you understand the difference between the frog on the left and the frog on the right? The frog on the left looks like a frog, which is an amphibian. And before I saw the site, I actually had forgotten. I thought frogs are mammals. So let me correct you, frogs are amphibians. The one on the left looks like a frog. The one on the right almost looks like a reptile. So I hope that the difference is very clear. And it's very, very well documented in all types of philosophy and literature that nothing gets transformed unless and until you put yourself through some serious discomfort, and unless and until you are willing to transform yourself. So, no, before you clap, let me also tell you that a lot of things I am going to say you are not going to like hearing them. But my job is not to say what you like to hear. My job is to say what I would do if I was an IFA in your shoes, actually. So the other thing which I did on the website, you will not be able to read this, but I will read it out for you. The meaning of leapfrog is to move from one position to another position, which is much ahead, without wasting or spending time in intermediate positions. So when you leapfrog, it has to be serious change and it has to be a serious transformation without going through many steps. You have to cover a lot of steps at the same time. And now let us see leapfrogging, and now let us see what does business model mean. Business model actually means, how do you design your business such that it generates the best possible revenue for you? So business model is not about which customer you meet and how much time you spend with them. Business model is about designing your business operations or the way you do your work. You have to design it in a way that it creates maximum revenue for you. So net-net, why I said the topic was very difficult is about, because it is about talking to you about how to multiply your revenue. Correct? The only way you can leapfrog in your revenue is to manage more clients. Either you increase the number of clients, or with the same number of clients, you have to get more revenue from those clients. Right? Now, I understand that most of the people in this hall are working as individuals. So if you're speaking to an audience of individuals and you expect that one single person will either manage more clients or extract more revenue from the same client. See, if you come to my company and tell me that I have to increase the revenue, it's a different story because there are 100 people in my team and we manage 9,000 crores. So that's a different thing. But if I come and tell you that you should increase your revenue, then probably not for everybody in the room, but probably for most people in the room, you are one individual person. So how do you actually change this? Now, if one individual has to change the revenue, then you have to really seriously think that from 9 in the morning till 6 in the evening or 7 or 8 in the evening, what exactly you are doing, where you are spending your time, and how you can utilize your time much better. Now, also keep in mind that if you want to increase your revenue, you also have to remember that what exactly do clients want. Now, if you want to find out what clients want, the easiest way to figure is to do some research, because nowadays there is Google. And just a few days back, I was looking for inflation on Google. So what I typed was that what is the value of 100 rupees in 1980? Now, if you see in Google, there is a feature that before you start typing, it starts prompting you. You see here what I have typed. I have typed value of rupees 1. And see what Google has prompted me. It has prompted everything about how 10,000 rupees became 600 crores. So I am looking for inflation, and all the prompts out of 6, 5 of the prompts are not about inflation. It is prompting about wealth creation. So we may think that we are in business of selling mutual funds. We may think we are in business of insurance or deposits or whatever it may be. But eventually, whatever we think our business is, what clients are looking for is wealth creation. So the first thing that is important for you before you start thinking about how to improve your revenue, the first and most important thing for you to do is to be very clear and define what business you are in. If you define your business very clearly, like my understanding is that my company, me, and according to me, most of us are in the business of creating wealth for our customers. And one of the speakers before me, he mentioned a gentleman from Coimbatore. I'm really sorry. I liked his speech. He's here. Yeah, I forgot. I'm really sorry. I missed your name. But he said a very interesting thing. His client has an income of 1 lakh rupees per month. But he wants to buy a diamond necklace which is worth 50 lakh rupees. So we can do all financial planning and SIP and everything we can do. But what we must not forget is that clients have dreams. And dreams don't follow inflation rates. Correct? And all this arithmetic progression of calculating inflation, matlab 2 ka 4 hoga, 4 ka 6 hoga, 6 ka 8 hoga, that arithmetical progression is very good with other people's money. On your own money, you always want geometric progression. So 2, 4, 6, 8 doesn't work. It has to be 2, 4, 8, 16, and 32. So we may think whatever business we may be in, but clients are very clear that they want wealth creation. So we are in the business of creating wealth for our customers. And now let's just see that from 9 to 6 or 9 to 9, however much we may be working, what we should be doing and where we are actually wasting our time. Now let's be clear, we are in the business of creating wealth for our customers. And what are the challenges that we actually face when we have to create wealth? The first thing I had told you was about managing more clients. Now I'm speaking to a group of individual people. This is not a company of 100 people. If you have to manage more clients, the first challenge you will face is how do you acquire more clients? The second is, if you acquired clients, how do you do transactions? Because in our country still, we are in the end of 2015, but more than 75% of all transactions done by all the people in this room are actually about filling application forms, filling checks, and giving it to CAMS or Karvi. You agree with me? Yeah. And then comes servicing. For some or the other reason, customers never get account statements, or I don't know where those statements go, but we all deliver account statements to our customers. And I was in an audience about 6 or 7 years back, no, actually 3 to 4 years back. I asked a group of people in a hall like this, more than 300 people. I asked them that, what is your USP as an advisor? What is your USP? What is your unique selling proposition? How are you different from the person sitting next to you? Out of 100, 99% of the people told me, I give good service. Now you tell me, who doesn't give good service? Does anybody say that I don't give good service? Is that a big differentiation? So you have to really think how you are different from the other person. So acquisition is a challenge, handling transactions is a challenge. If you do all of this, servicing and delivering statements and all those things are a challenge. Nowadays, technology, it is more confusing. I went to a conference recently where for 2 hours people were speaking on technology. There was a gentleman who was an IFA who at the end of the session came to me. He was very nervous. He said, what should I do with all of these things? I asked him, what is your customer segment? He said, I am handling 5 HNIs. I said, forget technology, you don't need it. You came to the wrong session. So it depends, what is your client segment? Who are you dealing with? If you have an existing base of customers, you can tell them that from tomorrow onwards, I am not going to pick up any paper. You learn to use the computer. But if you are going to acquire new customers, you cannot insist that they will come on the computer. The other challenge in our country now, and this is increasingly going to be a challenge whether we like it or not, increasing compliance, risk profiling, product suitably advised. It is not being monitored now, but it's a matter of time, it will be monitored. And continuity of business, because we are all individuals. When it comes to earning more from clients, what are the challenges? There is going to be reduction in expense ratios, and there is going to be a reduction in commissions. It has already started happening, whether we like it or not. The regulator is insisting that you should segregate distribution and advice. And the most important point, if point number one is true, then point number three is very important, which is that you need ability to charge the fees. Now the point is, why do we have customers? A lot of times people say we have customers because we want to help them with their goals, we want to service them, etc. Most important and simplistic thing, we have customers because we have to create wealth for them, and we have customers because we have to create value for ourselves. So we have to keep it simple. And what does it take to create wealth for customers? This is just a simple example. In the last 20 years, there are 7,000 listed companies. But in the last 20 years, there are 47 stocks whose value has gone up more than 100 times. So actually what you need to create wealth for your customers is 10 stocks which are held for next 10 years. In reality, what do we do from 9 in the morning till 9 in the evening? In our country today, we have 500 equity funds which are actually buying 200 to 250 stocks. Now, if a customer, we spend so much time in doing research, actually what the customer needs is 2 funds. We spend so much time in following so many products and so much that we actually don't focus on increasing number of customers. If we continue like this, eventually customers will get the return of BSE 200, because we are putting so many funds in so many portfolios, all our customers are having 300 stocks in the portfolio. The customer actually wants a completed car. And what are we offering? We are offering a tire separately, steering wheel separately, gears separately. We are focused on selling individual products, whereas customer wants the full assembly. The other important point, does your customer base actually look like this? The person you met at 11 in the morning, 2 in the afternoon, 4 in the evening, and 6 in the evening. I have presented this before at your conference, but I don't see many people following it. Is this how your customer base actually looking? How do you manage this kind of customer base? Do you think that if there are 100 different customers, you can give 100 different types of advice? So what you need is actually, you need to be able to classify your customers into 3 or 4 groups. And for all the customers in a particular group, see, you have a human mind, it's not a computer. You can remember four types of profiles. You cannot remember 100 different profiles. So you need to be able to segregate your base. And for all of these things, with all these constraints, how can you actually solve your problems? Selling individual products based on AMC's brand only with commission as a source of revenue is going to be difficult to continue, especially if you have same customers and same AUM, and if all these trends are happening, it's difficult. So it's very important that you simplify your business, use technology not to give it to your customers, use technology for you to be able to profile your customers. For existing customers, please stop using application forms and checks. There's a colleague of mine here, he's our South Zone head, his name is Vikas. He was telling me yesterday an advisor in Bangalore, he told him at 12:30 that you pick up a check of 1 crore rupees from a place which is 15 kilometers away. Now, my colleague, the bank fellow, the fellow in the registrar, in the operations office, and that advisor, all people put together must have spent 15 man hours just to ensure that the client got same day's NAV. And let me tell you, the client did not get the same day's NAV. Now, we are living in a world where he could have filled the form online, he could have transferred the money online, and nobody would have moved an inch. But here, there are 15 people trying to solve a problem, how a check can reach in 15 minutes, a distance of 15 kilometers, because it is 1 crore. So these are the things where we are actually spending our time, and then we discuss how to grow the business. So we need capability to be compliant with regulation, acquire and manage more clients, handle more transactions, stop working only towards a commission, but also be able to charge a fee. And for that, you need to use technology. Again, I'm saying not from your customer's perspective. Today, you are free to use any platform that you like. From whatever I understand, it is not my line of business, it is your line of business. But from whatever I understand today, right from national distributors to pure platforms, to IFAS, to Funds India, to NAC, to BAC, you have all the choice. MFU from AMFI, you have all the choice that you want. But it's high time that you do your homework, and instead of running around with forms and applications and checks, it's very important that you use technology for your own good. And this is the only way as an individual you can actually handle more customers and at the same time increase revenue from same set of customers. Platforms are to be used for two things. One, you might think that I am not an advisor, I am purely a distributor, so why should I use a platform? You still need a platform to make transactions easy. We are living in 2015. If you have to pay a taxi, they don't take cash nowadays. And we are here talking about investing crores of rupees in mutual funds. If all the people have to put all the money in mutual funds and we are going to roam around with checks, how do you think it is going to happen? I can tell you one thing for sure. In the next 1 year, we can meet again in 1 year. In the next 1 year, 1.5 lakh crore rupees will come into equity mutual funds. 1.5 lakh crores. If we all run around collecting forms and checks, this number will be 1.5 lakh crores. But if we use technology, this number can be even 2.5 lakh crores. Because one of the presenters before me said that habits change with generations. When I started my career, RBI used to issue bonds at 12% risk-free and tax-free. Today, there is no such culture. Everybody knows that if you want return, you have to take risk. But if we want to get all these people are on technology. So depending on which customer you are dealing with, you need to embrace technology, not for complicating life, only to ensure that you are not running around filling forms and cutting checks. If you want to leapfrog your business, out of my whole presentation of 15 minutes, if you have to take one point from here, I would urge you to stop using paper. Just stop using paper. There are a few other points. I think I've run out of time, so I'm not going to take a lot of your time in stressing them. Maybe I'll ensure that this presentation is circulated. People get very concerned that if they use a platform, their brand will be under threat. I don't think it works that way. There are enough number of neutral platforms which are available, which actually use your name for the front end. So you should not be scared of your brand. In any case, your brand gets shadowed with all these big AMC brands and their advertising. The other thing people fear is that if you use a platform, your revenue goes down. I don't think so. In fact, your business volume will go up, and there are very, very, very many platforms which ensure that apart from commission, you can actually charge fees as well. So my point is that if I was in your shoes, I would actually sit down and study these things deeply into detail. I would figure out what kind of clients I handle. I would figure out how to grow my business. And lastly, please stop using paper. For new customers, it's perfectly fine. But for all your existing customers, please put a deadline that after 1st January 2016, I will not use paper. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Rashish. May I invite Mr. Mohan Ram to kindly come on stage and present a memento to Mr. Rashish as a token of our gratitude.
Ashish, just to add, we use online for Flipkart, Amazon, everything else. So I'm sure we can adopt getting investors on board as well. Thank you so much.
A big round of applause to him. And for people who think that he's got the perfect Indian CEO look, I think you have to give a bigger round of applause to him, please. Thank you so much.